sing in praise of Target books. We scour the shelves and draw strange looks. In the children's section they stand and stare, because I'm too old to be there. A strange blue box is often found, producing wheezing, groaning sounds, stories of all space and time. I'll sort them all by colored spine.
Direction point! Direction point!
A Doctor Who Podcast Network.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back to Doctor Who Literature. My name is Jason, and this week Jim Sangster is back in the house to discuss The King's Demons, but we'll talk about that shortly. There has been a lot of other news in the world of Doctor Who, as well as a lot of correspondence to get to. We learned this past week that the new series of Doctor Who, the first full series starting Shuti Gatwa and Millie Gibson, will begin airing on Saturday, May 11th in the UK via streaming, which means episodes will air Friday evenings in America on May 10th, and then a terrestrial airing on the BBC, but streaming comes first. I checked in with Mark from Trap One, and Mark says, quote, "There has been a totally sane and rational reaction to that on Twitter, followed by a cry laughing emoji. I deleted my Twitter account on the 1st of January 2024, a decision I have not regretted for even half a second, and I am not sorry to be missing that scene, but I can only imagine what it's like when a certain section of grievance-prone Doctor Who fans get together on social media to complain about everything regarding the show. I told Mark, boy, do I not miss that scene. And Mark writes back, there's a petition and everything, followed by a facepalm emoji. Fortunately, he did not screenshot the petition for me. But anyway, what that means is that Doctor Who will be a Friday night show here in the States for those of us on Disney Plus. And that means that the first two episodes are going to be airing back to back on Friday, May 10th. And that will leave plenty of time for live reactions here on Doctor Who Literature, where I usually put the episodes to bed on Saturday night and release them Sunday morning, 7 a.m. UK time. Each episode will also be discussed on Trap One. I have not signed up for any episodes yet, but you can certainly hear my voice doing a full hour-long recap of probably at least one of the forthcoming episodes. Plus, of course, I'll try to give my instant reactions here on Doctor Who Literature as each new episode comes up in turn. In terms of where else you can find Jason in the podcast sphere, I was happy to appear last month on the latest episode of Who & Company, 81, with Drew and Brent. I've known Drew for a very long time, and I met Brent for the first time last year at L.I. Who. It's a very good show. We talk about Doctor Who in the first half of the episode, and then about Dark Shadows, the spooky American daily soap opera that ran from 1966 through 1971, which covered vampires, werewolves, and other demons and the forces of darkness, to coin a phrase. I am about 500 episodes into my Dark Shadows rewatch. I've been doing that two episodes a night since July 2023, and I was happy to talk about that with Drew and Brent on Who & Company. I will include a link in the show notes. I've also been on several episodes of Trap One lately, more than I can keep up with here, but I'll give you a brief rundown of my most recent Trap One appearances. Just yesterday, as this episode goes out, I appeared in a Trap One episode covering the recent Underwater Menace animation release. That was me and Cy and Fraser, well known, of course, to this podcast. last month, Mark and I released our episode covering Gallifrey 1. We were both there, and we recorded the episode live on location with several other guests who joined us for a few minutes at a time. Also in February, I moderated The Daleks in Color, which is just coming out on home media. And my guests for that episode were UK Jason and Adam Clegg, both of which have been on this show a couple of times. I will be on more Trap One episodes in the future, and of course I will discuss those here as they come up. Before we get to the King's Demons, let's answer some listener mail. First up is a great letter from James Sumnall. He writes, "Thank you for the wonderful weekly podcasts you produce with evident dedication and thoughtfulness. I genuinely appreciate the treat they provide on my Sundays, whether I'm indulging in leisure, or I suppose as James would say, leisure, or out for a run, eagerly tuning in to the latest installment. Having watched Mark of the Ronnie during its initial broadcast, I already had fond memories of the episode, being both terrified by the dinosaur and captivated by the Ronnie's TARDIS. And yes, while I did take a couple of cheap shots at the dinosaur last week, I don't think I discussed this, but the Ronnie TARDIS control room interior is just absolutely wonderful. I was smitten with that when I first saw the story at age 12, and I 1000% agree with you, James. Back to the email. Episode 106 brought an unexpected twist for me. As Michael discussed the industrial history of Iron Bridge Gorge and Blist's Hill, he mentioned details like the blast furnaces and the blue pools used for clay. To my astonishment, I was jogging past these landmarks. I live nearby to Blist's Hill and the furnaces. I vividly recall the school in Sturgley Village being dismantled brick by brick and relocated to the museum. Your podcast not only entertained me, but also fostered a sense of closeness, as Michael's anecdotes struck a chord with me. Thank you so much, James. Really appreciate it, and I'll be reaching out to you very shortly." Also heard from Kevin in Columbus. If you recall, Kevin sent me an audio clip that I was desperately hoping to use last week, but we never were able to figure out what was wrong with the audio file, but it cannot be imported into the editing program that I use to make this show. Kevin writes, "I am writing this just after I heard about when Doctor Who's next series is being released, on May 10th with a two-episode premiere. That means a May-June block for Friday nights in the US and Canada. Well, after Shruti Gatwa's cameo at the Oscars, you had to know that Disney had to announce something big was coming for Doctor Who, and boy, was that big. So does that mean the recording block will move for Doctor Who literature?" No, Kevin, it does not. I do plan on sticking to my Sunday morning release schedule. I've been doing that weekly for almost 2.5 full years now, and it's working out pretty well for me, whereas this next Doctor Who season is only going to be 7 broadcast weeks long, so I think sticking to my Sunday morning release schedule will be just about fine. So those are my most noteworthy emails for the week. My thanks, as always, to my viewers for writing in and telling me what they enjoy or don't enjoy about the show. And thanks so much to James and Kevin this week for their positive and thoughtful comments. If you want to email the show, please do so at Doctor Who Literature, that's drwholiterature@gmail.com. And if you have a podcast that you would like me to appear on, please reach out to me at the same place. I should also be remiss in pointing out that I was on a recent episode of Gallifrey's Most Wanted with Ross, a very outspoken and good friend of this program. Ross and I discussed the very first 1991 New Adventure novel, and that is Doctor Who Time Worm Genesis, by a friend of this show, John Peel. Although Time Worm Genesis was the first New Adventure, it was not the first original Doctor Who novel. That honor went to Turlough and the Earthling Dilemma, which I discussed on this show 2 weeks ago with Dale Smith. I've been asked often if I intend to cover the New Adventures on this program after I run out of target novelizations. I've only got about 1 year's left worth of those. At the moment, I don't plan on covering the New Adventures because there are several other podcasts which cover that ground. And it is difficult to cover the New Adventures on a weekly basis because the books are twice as long as the targets. But, as somebody once said, time will tell, Ace. It always does. Meanwhile, let's welcome back to the show once again, Jim Sangster. The musical parody at the top of the hour was, of course, the work of the incomparable Jim. I don't know how he does it, but I'm very glad that he does it. And I'm very glad that he does it for this show. Jim has also created the second video for Doctor Who Literature, and this is going to be going up on our YouTube channel, which is YouTube/@ Doctor Who Novels. That's D-R Who Novels. Please check out and subscribe to the channel if you have not done so already. It is primarily a repository for the podcast episodes without additional video, but if Jim is going to make a live video for us, I am putting it up on YouTube. So, before you join us there, let's come back to this show, and let's get to it.
You are invited on an adventure across all of time and space, in a completely random order. It's the Police Box in the Junkyard podcast. Jump in the TARDIS with your hosts,
Eric Gulbranson,
Asad Cheshki,
and
Matthew Kressel.
Explore Doctor Who TV stories, audio adventures, and books, both novels and non-fiction. The Police Box in the Junkyard podcast. It's the entire Whoniverse. On Shuffle. The Police Box in the Junkyard podcast is a member of the Direction Point Network and is available about once a month wherever you find your podcasts. You are listening to the Doctor Who Literature podcast.
I'll hit record on this end.
Jim Sangster, it's been a minute since you've been on the show, and by a minute, I mean probably 2 or 3 weeks. Welcome back, my friend.
Bonjour, ça va?
Now, we always start off by comparing our T-shirts, and you are wearing the Junior Gazette, or the masthead from the Junior Gazette. Is that one of your own designs?
Well, it's the logo from the Junior Gazette, which is the newspaper at the heart of Stephen Moffat's press gang. But it is one of my designs. I sort of made it jaggedy, and it's available on Redbubble. But it's also a reference to the fact that the first book I wrote was a probing guide to press gang, with the help of Stephen and with his producer, Sandra. As a consequence of writing that book, I actually own the archives of Press Gang. So I've all the scripts, including some of the letters Stephen wrote back and forth with his producer, including one very terse one where they clearly had a debate about something and he just sent it with, Sandy, please like this. it's a obscure little reference just for my benefit, really.
I am not wearing a Jim Sangster shirt today. I am wearing my Wicker Man shirt, in keeping with British folk horror. But you can't see it because Smudge is blocking my view and staring directly at you into the webcam, so you cannot see my shirt. But I will tell you, Jim, that two of my most recent guest interviews have shown up to the interview wearing Jim Sangster originals. I sent you a photo from the back patio at Gallifrey 1 of Simon Gurrier and myself both wearing your shirts. And then when Michael Storm was on last week talking about the Mark of the Ronnie, he was wearing the shirt that you designed for this show, the Ghastly Woke Zombie shirt.
It was so nice to see another member of the army assembling and joining in. So it's a badge of pride that now, isn't it? I'm happily a ghastly woke zombie. I wonder how much I can start to shoehorn in about medieval and historical adventures. I've no idea.
What's interesting is that last week's book, The Mark of the Ronnie, is for the Master 3 episodes after this one, because Anthony Ainley was on the show once or twice every season for a good long run of time. So season 19, he's in 2 serials, Castor Velvet and Time Flight. Season 20, he is in this serial that we're talking about today, The King's Demons and The Five Doctors, which technically is not season 20, but it aired in the same calendar year. And then he is back for Planet of Fire, season 21, which we've already covered on this show. And season 22, he's back for The Mark of the Ronnie, which we've already covered on the show. And then after that, he's back for The Ultimate Foe, which is coming up eventually. And then Survival, which has the distinction of being my least favorite classic series serial ever, and that is coming up towards the very end of the show, as it was one of the final books. So there's a lot going on the Master's timeline, and I understand that a little bit later on during the hour, you have a grand unifying theory for us about the Master's role in The King's Demons.
I'm presenting it. It's not my theory. It's completely stolen off someone much cleverer. But I think it's lovely though that this is two consecutive master stories, even though they're the wrong way around. The fact that you've just done Mark of the Rani and now we're looking at the King's Demons a week later.
It's completely coincidental because we are going on this show, as you know, in publication order rather than story order. But there are times when there are these neat little confluences and pairs of books that are perfectly thematically matched, even though they're being adjacent, not Jason, but adjacent in the publication schedule is completely an accident. And obviously, Vengeance on Varus, which is not a master story, was supposed to be right there and ended up being delivered 2 years late. But we have this nice little confluence of two out-of-order master stories back-to-back on the production schedule.
Yeah, it's funny when I was looking at the, like on my blog and seeing chapter 107 is The King's Demons, but this is book 108 because of that strange Varos thing. I wonder why they, because it didn't really matter, did it? It didn't really matter where things slotted. I wonder why they didn't just make this one 107.
It's possible because the cover art had already been painted and filed and it said 106 and they decided to just leave it. Maybe they thought Varos was going to come out much earlier than it ended up coming out. And then after Varos finally comes out 2 years late, you have this glorious error where there are two book 127s.
I'm not very good at numbers anyway. I run out of fingers after 10. And even making that joke, I just paused going, is it 10?
So before we get to the possibly unpleasant task of talking about King's Demons, a Doctor Who story, which I believe I am the only person ever in history who's had a favorable impression of it, let's talk about other things. You have been crushing it on this show with your artwork. Your logo ended up being repurposed into Doctor Who Literature business cards and Doctor Who Literature stickers, which went like hotcakes at Gallifrey One last month. And of course, there's your Ghastly Woke Zombie shirt, which one of my guests wore last week. And then there are your musical numbers. There are many of them, including the one that we heard at the top of this show, plus many more to come, I'm happy to say. And you are now branching out into Doctor Who Lit videos for my nascent and not yet very heavily trafficked YouTube channel. Tell us a little bit, because I can't show it to you, the audience, but you will be able to go on YouTube and watch it separately. Tell us a little bit about your video creation.
Well, I always like to have a project, you know, and obviously during lockdown, the project was the blog. And then I've been learning how to do things like GarageBand and, you know, very, very simplistically. I'm self-taught on Photoshop, and although I got a lot of help from people like Lee Binding and Clay Hickman, and I always like to have a project. And this year I decided I want to learn how to animate with no idea about whether that's even possible, but I can see loads of other people doing it. I'm thinking maybe I can have a go. So I've done... I did a very basic animation for the song I did for Enlightenment, which pretty much just involves mouths opening and closing and a bit of blinking. And then I was guided towards the Adobe Animate suite. And I had a bit of a hellish evening trying to get to grips with the lip sync, but I think I've cracked it. So now that's for a video that will be coming up later on this year. And now I've done this one. So they are very, very basic. Without going into any details, because I don't want to bore your audience, they're being very therapeutic for me because it's been a bit of a tough time. So to do something creative that where I can hyper-focus and just find my way has been fun. And hopefully each video that I try, I'll learn one new skill and then show it off.
You always undersell yourself and you don't give yourself enough credit. You are afraid of boring the audience. I do a show once a week that is between 90 and 120 minutes, which primarily is me either talking to myself, reading out the audio essay, or talking over my guest. If the audience can tolerate 90 minutes of Jason talking to himself every week for the last 2.5 years, you spending 3 minutes talking about Adobe Animate is not going to bore this audience. You are talking to the survivors. You are talking to the people who have buckled up and said, if we can handle 90 minutes of Jason, we can handle anything in life.
Well, thank you very much. Like a lot of only children, I crave attention and then I get it and I don't know how to cope. So I'm just sitting here embarrassed. And can we move on, please?
All right. Let's talk about last week's episode. Last week, we're talking about the Mark of the Ronnie. Not my favorite story. It is one of my favorite stories of season 22, but I think that says more about season 22 than it does about the story. However, before this recording, I was having a conversation over Zoom with Conrad, who was asking for my help with a different non-Doctor Who lit-related subject. And he was telling me that he loves Mark of the Ronnie and Pip and Jane Baker. And Conrad also says hello to you, by the way.
Hello, Conrad.
Always a pleasure to have Conrad's name mentioned on the show. Conrad is listening on Sunday night, so hello, Conrad. Pleasure to have spoken to you a few days ago. Speaking of Mark of the Ronnie, which is one of Conrad's favorite stories, and I like it, don't love it, not in my top 60, but it is one of my favorite Colin Bakers by default. So on last week's show, when Michael Storm and I were discussing the Mark of the Ronnie, we were desperate to fill out the hour without spending an hour talking about Mark of the Ronnie, and we ended up diverging to talk about classic children's literature and detective literature. So I was talking quite a bit about my American obsession, the Hardy Boys, and Michael was talking about Sexton Blake. And I understand that triggered an association for you, which I am not positive that I am aware of.
Well, yeah, I didn't really know who Sexton Blake was. It just happened to be that I, many years ago, worked on the desk adjacent to a fellow called Mark Hodder, who, as far as I know, is probably the world expert on Sexton Blake. And it's one of those subjects I knew nothing about. I got him to write an article for our website about it. And basically, when Sherlock Holmes looked like he was going to get killed off the first time, another publisher decided to do very similar stories for a younger audience, Sexton Blake. These caught the attention of Sidney Newman. So when Sidney Newman, you know, he's done Doctor Who, he's looking for the next big thing to do, he decides he wants the BBC to adapt Sexton Blake, and then he hits a block. He can't get the rights for it. So instead, he founds a TV show called Detective, where he does all of the other detectives he can get his hands on, including Sherlock Holmes. It's an anthology series that runs for a few years. Not all of them survive, you know, like a lot of stuff from those days. But there's some very interesting stories. Some of them are modern, some of them are from history. And one of them was The Speckled Band, the Sherlock Holmes story. And as a consequence of that being quite successful, it span off into two series. So the first one was starring Douglas Wilmer. The second one starred Peter Cushing. And I mentioned all this just to say this was frustrating for Sidney Newman, because what he really wanted to do was Sexton Blake. Years later, there was actually a TV show of Sexton Blake, and it starred Lawrence Payne. And I believe, so Lawrence Payne will know from The Two Doctors, which you've already done, and The Gunfighters.
So, speaking of Lawrence Payne and the happy confluence of books, we have two master books back-to-back between Mark of the Ronnie and The King's Demons. But we had a Lawrence Payne confluence a couple of months ago, because he was in book 100, The Two Doctors, in which Conrad was one of my guests. Hello again, Conrad. And he was also in book 101, The Gunfighters, in which you were my guest. So Lawrence Payne has also been a popular fixture on Doctor Who literature the last couple of months.
And of course, he was in The Leisure Hive in episode one, so you've already done that one. But
with Diamond Heart several months ago.
This is one of those... When you read a lot of the archives about Doctor Who, and there are certain stories that just sit in the back of your mind. So again, Sexton Blake. I knew that Sidney Newman wanted to do Sexton Blake. The other thing is I knew that Lawrence Payne had played Sexton Blake. And I believe, and forgive me if I've got this wrong, but I believe it was on Sexton Blake that he had an accident where he lost his eye, which is why the characters he plays in The Leisure Hive and The Two Doctors have got glass eyes. Not that you can really see them. But apparently he's got an artificial eye.
I don't think I was aware of that, being an American and not an expert on Lawrence Payne per se. Is this an industrial accident that happened on set as a result of production, or did it happen during a break in filming when he was off set or at home? Or
I believe it was in my head, the back of my mind, the version of this is that it was a sword fight. So it would be something particularly nasty.
Oh my goodness, that's horrifying. Obviously, it didn't slow down his career because he comes back to Doctor Who a couple more times and is still hale and hearty and giving very unique performances. But that's a terrible thought, and especially in terms of occupational health and safety, that is a very black mark on whoever directed it and staged that episode.
I would imagine he'd be on a BBC health and safety course soon after, in the same way that Russell T. Davis is actually responsible for a segment on the BBC health and safety course because of a time when he accidentally blew up a presenter.
So we've been talking now for a little over 10 minutes, which is traditionally the part of the hour where we segue to talk about the book of the week. I will mention this a little bit more in my audio essay, so I'm not going to preempt myself. I will just say that of all the Doctor Who fans who have opinions about stories, you have a Venn diagram of people who are Doctor Who fans. That's one circle. You have another circle of people who like The King's Demons. I think I am quite possibly the only fan in the history of ever who is at the overlap between those two circles. I saw King's Demons very early on in my fandom journey because Doctor Who was being aired 5 nights a week, one episode a night, and I picked up with Time Flight, and I really got into it in season 20 thanks to Arc of Infinity and Modern Undead and Enlightenment. King's Demons comes up very soon after Enlightenment. There was never a time when I have not enjoyed watching the story, and of course, the Chameleon and the song, all things we'll talk about. King's Demons spoke to me very early on, and I have things to say about the novelization and things to say about the TV series, but it's always surprised me that I am possibly the lone defender of this story. I was recently on the Trap 1 episode covering the Season 20 Blu-ray collection in early January. It's now mid-March, and I was preaching my gospel of the King's Demons. I was on another now-defunct podcast a couple of years ago talk about Season 20 in general and saying nice things about the King's Demons and getting a very comically outraged response from one of the co-hosts. Why do you think... is The King's Demons a story that most fans, especially of a certain age, our generation, don't have much time for?
Well, firstly, in the words of Whoopi Goldberg when she was playing a singer pretending to be a nun, I will follow you wherever you may roam. Because I've always been a fan of this story. I really enjoy it. But then when I first saw it, I'd just turned 12 the previous month. I didn't have any critical faculties. It was just more Doctor Who. I didn't discover that it was possible to not like Doctor Who until season 22. So, you know, when I joined fandom and then I was educated with how to hate. So maybe I would have liked every single Doctor Who story if I'd not made that fateful journey to a house and join fandom.
And put a pin in that thought, because when we come back and have you on for Terror of the Vervoids, we're going to have a lot to say about that particular topic.
Mm. But I think one of the reasons why people might not rate this as highly as they could is, firstly, it's a two-parter. And at this era, a two-parter always feels like it's going to be a bit slight. It's always something that's just a bit of a filler. They're never important. They're never big stories. And we're not quite at the point where we can have three-parters yet, because Doctor Who is made in couplets. It's at this point, it's because it's made in 2 nights a week, weeknights. So everything has to be in units of two. So we've got this very slight story. The more you think about it, the sillier it gets as well, because why is the Master pretending to be a French champion? Why is he wearing that wig? Why is he wearing the whole thing? And the whole plan, well, we'll get to this later, but the whole plan is ridiculous. But I think If you start criticising a Doctor Who story for having a ridiculous plot, we wouldn't have a lot left over. So I think we can forgive that, first of all. It's just an adventure story. Secondly, it's Terence Dudley riding high on the success of Black Orchid. And I suppose the success of the first Doctor Who spin-off with K-9 and Company, in that it made it to air. And he'd spent a decade trying to get onto Doctor Who. And I don't want to speculate why he didn't get on to Doctor Who, but it might have been because other people worked with him when he was working on Doomwatch. And maybe when they got into the position of commissioning people, they thought, hell no, we're not commissioning him. He's an absolute nightmare. But he desperately wanted to be in Doctor Who, and he managed three of them. Black Orchid turned out to be the highest rated Peter Davison story. And just because of whatever was happening for the first episode, this is the lowest rated. And as we said before, TV ratings are not an indication of quality.
Speaking of Terence Dudley, when he was hired to work on Doctor Who during JNT's first year, he was hired as a director rather than a writer. And the story they gave him to direct was, I believe, Meglos. So this is someone who is usually given the short end of the stick in terms of Doctor Who. But K-9 and Company was a success. It was highly rated. It resulted in a novelization, which we're going to talk about on this show in a couple of months. And you're not my guest for the K-9 and Company episode, but I plan on asking my guests for that episode, what is a better pilot? A Girl's Best Friend or Invasion of the Bane? And I think I'm working on an argument that A Girl's Best Friend is actually the better pilot episode for the spin-off series. So that's, again, that was a heavily rewritten script. Eric Sayward is the script editor. The novelization is based on an older draft and is quite different from what made it to air as K-9 and Company. But I think Terence Dudley is perhaps unfairly maligned, possibly because he never wrote a four-part story except for the Doomsday, which also usually ranks very low on people's lists. I think he's possibly deserving of a fresh take and the critical reevaluation. But you and I, again, are two people who like this story, and there aren't too many more of us.
I mean, strangely enough, I remember when everyone loved Black Orchid, and then Gary Gillett wrote a review for Doctor Who magazine, and I now know it was just another one of those exercises he did. He didn't write a slating review because that was necessarily his opinion. It was because the jokes were there to lead him into that. In the same way that he praised certain stories that we know are terrible because he wanted to see, is it possible to find the good in it? But after he reviewed Black Orchid, everyone suddenly went, Black Orchid's really slim and it's really terrible and we all hate it. And I don't know whether that had a knock-on effect as well, but I think that damaged the perception of Terence Dudley. I mean, you'll be talking about his writing later on. We can talk about how he is quite good at capturing the characters, but he's also a misogynistic old dinosaur. And especially, I think, in this book, that I don't think the book does him any favours, because in some ways it's beautifully written. I love the opening paragraph, the opening chapters, where he's passing the point of view from character to character, and it's so elegantly done as it goes from Sir Ranulph to his wife to their son and then to the Master watching everything. Sorry, Sir Gilles watching everything. There's a spoiler for you. And it's so elegantly done. And then he gets a real sense of Turlough. He's quite good at capturing who Turlough is. He just is really nasty with Tegan. I think he's unforgivably nasty with Tegan.
I am going to be talking about this at length in my audio essay. And not to preempt myself, but I believe Terence Dudley was the oldest person to write a Doctor Who script up to this point in time, and possibly not too many people after are much older than this man, who was in his early 60s. It may have been a generational thing. And Black Orchid, which is his final novelization and the final Peter Davison novelization, but doesn't come out until 1987, that book does go out of its way to be more charitable to Tegan, and it goes inside of her head more in a non-judgmental way. Possibly somebody at Target had a word with Terrence Dudley, or possibly he realized that he took things too far inadvertently and wanted a correct course.
It is funny. I mean, when you start reading it and all Tegan is doing is moaning about the cold, and that's kind of what, you know, Donna would do. But it's just done with a lot less charm than Donna. You do get a sense that, I mean, Tegan's wearing that very, she's got a nice big fur coat, but a very flimsy dress. And, you know, maybe she is cold. It's a legitimate thing to say, but for that to become her main defining character trait is a bit unfortunate. She just wants to go back in the TARDIS, not because of any perceived danger, but just because it's freezing.
We're also talking about the author of Ford of Doomsday, which is one of Tegan the character's weakest outings, where she ends up having a fist fight with Adric. That may have been... Well, I can't say that it's the influence of Eric Sayward because he wasn't around for Ford of Doomsday, but this is the second time where Terrence has written for Tegan and not given her a very fair shake.
Mm. There's also in... Ford of Doomsday famously features the indigenous Australian characters, and it's a bit sort of culturally tone deaf, I think. It's quite clumsy. And then again, in this book, he has Tegan imagining what would the Aborigines be like in the 13th century. Probably the same as they were in the 1980s. And then the character comes out with something which is quite horrible and dismissive. And we're kind of used to this by now, aren't we? Where if a character starts speaking in a way that might seem out of step for how they usually are, it's probably the voice of the author leaking in. You know, he's an old man. He's got his views. Maybe they're not even strongly held views, but it's just a sense of, oh, this is acceptable. This is okay for a character to say. I don't want to necessarily lean into the ghastly woke zombie thing too heavily, but for those of us who are sensitive to this, it can be an unpleasant surprise when you get lines like the one that Tegan is for no reason other than he's trying to spell out that she's Australian. In the same way that they keep going on about she's obsessed with London Airport, because when we first meet her, she's going for a job as an air hostess. And then 3 years later, they're still pretending she's an air hostess when she got sacked from that job.
And that's, in fact, the very last line of the book, even though this comes out in TV order, this comes out, you're right, a year after she is fired, in between Time Flight and Arc of Infinity. I was going to say, though, up until about 20 years ago, cultural insensitivity was the norm. When I grew up, I don't know if this exists outside of the New York tri-state area, but Polish jokes were a thing when I was a kid, and Mad Magazine, which was very, very far to the left, and I think a lot of my politics come from having read Mad Magazine between the ages of 8 and 11. Mad Magazine flipped those on its head by doing a cartoon series in the early 80s, American jokes they're telling in Poland. What's gray, sits in a windowsill, hums, and dies after 91 days? Answer. An American air conditioner on a 90-day warranty. So my daughter and I have been binge-watching our way through Buffy the Vampire Slayer, one episode a night. And as you and I record this, we are 21 episodes down. We are halfway through the first two-parter in Season 2, What's My Line? We just got to the great cliffhanger with I Am Kendra, the Vampire Slayer. So that means 5 nights ago, we watched Inca Mummy Girl, and Buffy the Vampire Slayer was generally progressive about most things, even though we now know a little too much about its creator and showrunner. But in Inca Mummy Girl, a character arrives at Sunnydale who is believed to be a regular Peruvian teenager. Giles immediately hands to this regular Peruvian teenager a bit of broken pottery that is 500 years old and asks her to translate it. I mean, talking about cultural insensitivity passed off as everyday normal behavior. Hat tip to my friend Dave Ford, who pointed this out to me. And once you see it, you cannot unsee it. And my daughter was just howling with laughter at how inappropriate this is. And this is only an episode of TV that's barely 25 years old. I was already a man grown when it came out the first time. So I think cultural insensitivity was everybody's birthright up until probably the early 2000s. So even shows that were doing the right thing were getting it wrong when it comes to addressing other cultures. So it is hardly a fault that it is unique to Terence Dudley. This is hardly the only Doctor Who story that even makes that error. So I think all we can do is grimace and move on and still enjoy the show regardless and just develop a blind spot. Because if you were to be that critical, you would have to lose a lot of Doctor Who from the canon, and then we wouldn't have a show to talk about.
I think when, like with Buffy the Vampire Slayer, at the time it was hitting it out the park in terms of representation and gender roles, and it was doing a lot of good. Now, that doesn't mean it did everything good, and also the way it went about it wasn't necessarily, well, we know now it wasn't good, but it was trying to do something different and trying to do something better. I watch a lot of old stuff, and whereas Monty Python is incredibly famous around the world, the goodies less so. And at the time that I was growing up, we had both of them as cultural influences. Monty Python is intellectually funny, whereas The Goodies is silly, and it's very, very funny. However, the number of times, for no really strong reason, they decide to dress up as black and white minstrels is becoming a little bit boring as I'm watching my way through it. I still believe that the people involved were good people, and they're doing that to ridicule racism, but it's kind of like having your cake and eating it. And I mention that just because this is a book where I was reading through it and there's a reference to the minstrels. And for a start, for a brief second, I thought, oh, no. And then I thought, oh, no, it's a court minstrel. It's not the same thing at all. it's not an unfortunate cultural reference. Although me drawing a parallel to it probably is.
Let's segue then to talk about the song. This song, that I first would have heard it in late 1984, instantly became an earworm. I have spoken in the past, and I mean this literally, there is rarely a day that goes by when I do not have the Ballad of the Last Chance Saloon playing endlessly in my head. Now, my daughter has recently been mainlining the Heathers the Musical soundtrack, and she was just cast in a junior version of a Sondheim play for her junior high school spring play. So we have a lot of musicals going on here in the Doctor Who literature household. That sort of crowds out room for Linda Barron, but don't worry, Linda. You'll be back in my head as soon as we get over our Heathers phase. Whatever part of my head is not currently taken up with Dead Girl Walking reprise. But the King's Demon song is not too far behind. And here I am, a Jewish kid in suburbia, getting ready for his bar mitzvah, going around singing, "To free the tomb of Christ our Lord." My parents were giving me funny looks. So,
we sing in praise of total war against the Saracen we abhor. To free the tomb of Christ our Lord, we'll put the known world to the sword. There is no glory greater than to serve with gold the Son of Man. No riches here on earth shall see, no scutage in eternity.
Does the song increase the quality of the episode, or is it a complete waste of time that needs to be made fun of at top volume?
It has two purposes, really, because it's telling us the story of this is the political background where, I mean, there's the all things bright and beautiful thing, you know, where the rich man in his castle, the poor man at his gate. There's this propaganda from religion in general, which says if you're poor, that's how God wants you to be. Just accept it. Never challenge it. Don't question the status quo. And at this point, because the king is seen as God appointed, even though King John's entire family are pretty much just self-appointed, through a series of battles, they become the monarchy. And it was very fragile the whole time they were in power. But it's words like scutage, which you go running to look up, and you find out that scutage is basically because the king is God appointed. He has the right to demand all of your wealth. I'm just going to quickly sidestep. In the book, especially, Sir Ranulph and his wife, Isabella, they're described as being in love. And that's quite a strange thing. At this time, marriage is about unions between households and families to create alliances. It's not a romantic act. And yet they are passionately in love with each other. It's a wonderful thing. And it's sketched out in just a little line. I'll just throw in as well the fact that Sir Ranulph's wife's name is Isabella. And we can tell that this isn't the real king because at no point does he say, oh, my first wife's name was Isabella. Huh. Come to think of it, so is my second wife's name. She's Isabella too. I fought a war over that one. So that it should surely be a giveaway to Sir Ranulph. This isn't the real king, because he doesn't at any point go, Isabella, not fond of that one. But oh, sorry. Yeah. So the point of the song.
That cannot be a coincidence that he names her Isabella. He must have known that King John's wives were both Isabellas. He must have known.
I think possibly Terence Dudley was reading the Ladybird book of the monarchy or something. I don't know, but it's like in this book he throws in a few little flavors of history without it being like Time Flight is really heavy about the fact that he's done his research. Whereas this is, it's there as a flavor and it does draw you in. I think it's really nicely done.
So did you mean Time Flight or Black Orchid?
Time Flight. So the book of Time Flight is horrific for, I've done my research about planes, so I'm going to cram in everything I know about planes.
Yeah. Peter Grimwood, yes.
Yeah. Whereas this, with Terence Dudley, is he's showing that he's at least got an awareness of the history, but he's also using that to tell us that Sir Ranulph knows this man. He's fought wars with him. He's fought battles with him. He's risked his life and his health with him. He knows him well enough to know this fella's a ringer. But the other thing is, the song's written by Peter Howell. And because he's working in the radiophonic workshop and he's an employee of the BBC like Jonathan Gibbs, that frees up Jonathan Gibbs to quote from it. So we have the song, but then we also have quotes from the song in the soundtrack, which reinforces it so that when we come back to it later on and the song leads the doctor to find who is behind the door, and spoiler, it's not the king, the song has to be memorable enough for us to go, oh yeah, so this is the king singing. And then we open the door and find out, oh, no, it's not. This is interesting. So I think it's a good song. It's a really strong song. It's beautifully written. Once again, even in a mediocre story like this, Peter Howell is contributing the best thing to it, I'd say. And I'm saying that as a fan. I know it's a mediocre story, but I do like it.
One of the perils of Doctor Who, especially in the first half of the 1980s, is that scripts, ideas are often hijacked by John Nathan Turner for marketing purposes. I don't think it was Terence Dudley's intention to create a malfunctioning robot prop to be a companion. I believe the idea of Chameleon was foisted upon him by John Nathan Turner, who either was sold a bill of goods about what the prop could do, or was given a functioning prop whose owner then tragically died and nobody else knew how to operate the darn thing. Is Chameleon a mistake on John Nathan Turner's part, or is it an idea that they just could have gone with, and as was suggested on the Trap 1 episode a couple of months ago, I believe by Pete Lambert, couldn't they have just had a different actor play Chameleon every week the way that Gerald Flood plays him here with limited use of the prop, and have Chameleon be a more integral part of every story going forward until he's written out in Planet of Fire. So in other words, how big of a mistake is Chameleon, and does it drag this story down with it?
It's strange that John Nathan Turner got rid of K-9 and the Sonic Screwdriver because he felt that they were too easy to help the plot out. And then he introduces a character who can change their shape, who can pose as the villain, or can pose as anyone. And that is surely very, very easy. That's my first question, is looking at this from a marketable point of view, but surely the marketable idea is that this character can change shape. So it's not like necessarily the toy would be the exciting thing. It's the concept that it can be anyone. You could have had celebrity guest stars galore playing that character. But maybe it's because they lost confidence when its creator died. But even then, you could have had Chameleon, as indeed they did do in the following series. You can prop the robot up and just work around it and shoot it well. But it is a bit of a daft idea. I mean, you get all excited, and then I think he loses interest in it as soon as he realizes how complicated it is, how it's slowing the production down, how it's already frustrating. I mean, they've already, by this point, they already know that they've lost the last story of the season. And his main thing now is, well, we've got to have the anniversary story in production. We've got to get that. So we'll sacrifice a Dalek story for that thing. And he's looking at this robot going, it's a great idea. And if it worked, it would be quite impressive. At the time, it was quite impressive, I suppose. But I think it just shows that John was more sort of strategic than creative. There was a very easy and fun creative solution to that he didn't take up.
This is also, and this is a fair criticism, this is a story that does not come to a logical conclusion with a clever resolution. It is a story that basically just stops because they've run out of minutes in episode 2. So the Doctor and the Master fight a battle for the soul of Chameleon that has no relation to what's come during the previous episode and a half. And there's no resolution to the storyline between Ranulf and the death of Jeffrey DeLacy and the imprisonment of Ranulf and Isabella's son, who now hates the Doctor. The novelization fixes this, and I assume this is all stuff that Terence Dudley invented for the novelization that was not part of the original draft, or I have not spent enough time looking at the BD-ROM for the season 20 material. That's my bad. Maybe this was the original plot, and I got sacrificed when Chameleon got written into the story, and Terence Dudley is reinstating it. But that's a fair point. This is a story that doesn't have a very good resolution on TV. Do you think the book works better because the book manages to tie up all these loose ends and has the story come to a logical conclusion that is not just a Chameleon-inspired mental sword fight?
Yes. In a word, yes. The problem is that it's inheriting a lot of stuff from... I mean, it's weird that this is spiritually a sequel to Time Flight. No one wants a sequel to Time Flight, but maybe that's Eric Saywood just going, oh, I want it to all be joined up, so let's make this robot something to do with Zerafast. It's not really that well explained. It's just, I mean, Time Flight isn't very well explained. The Master had some sort of dealing with a dual entity on Zerafast. And now we find out that there's this shape-shifting thing that also comes, or he got it while he was messing around on Zerafast. It's a convenience. It's an interesting thing to go, I've got a fake king, and it turns out to be a shape-changing robot. That's a nice little twist. It's a Doctor Who-type twist. But it is daft, isn't it? It is bonkers.
I have been asking all my guests over the last few months the three Darren Mooney questions from the 250 podcast, which I love, even though their episodes are longer than mine. Also a weekly show, and their episodes could be up to 3 hours long. So I have to pick my spots. You recently asked me about this podcast because you were looking for something new to listen to during a journey. Have you had a chance to listen to it yet?
Oh, yeah. And It's funny because as I'm getting used to the characters, there's one person who's got all the information and is desperately trying to get all that information out. And there's another one who's just looking for the joke. And I suppose a bit like the inhabitants of Zarephath, that sounds like both sides of me, where I desperately want to get all the information out, but I am trying to build towards a joke at the same time. I'm really enjoying it. I've had three recommendations for different podcasts about different subjects in the last month, and all three of them involve people from Ireland. And that's basically where my family comes from, and it's obviously come from Liverpool. I've got connections to Ireland, and I've got loads of friends from Ireland as well. So yeah, it's a lovely thing. But as soon as I got to the end of the first one, I thought, oh, that's where you're getting your questions from. I get it now.
Darren Mooney, who hosts the 250, and he's the one who's getting the information out, he is also a Doctor Who fan, and he is the author of the Black Archives volume on Kill the Moon, which does not tie in with another story from the same TV season, Mummy on the Orient Express, but Christopher Villiers from The King's Demons comes back for Mummy on the Orient Express and is very, very good there in a role where he dies tragically/heroically towards the end of the story. I will ask you the Darren Mooney questions for King's Demons. Does The King's Demons belong on a list of the 60 best Doctor Who TV serials of the first 60 years?
I think it's a shame that since you've been asking this question, the consensus for every single one is no. Absolutely
or,
not.
God, no. Those are usually the two. Because we are in the middle, Jim, of a run of books that have relative merits, but they are books all in a row for TV stories that are not particularly well received. The Crotons, which is not one of Robert Holmes' best. The Two Doctors, which is not one of Robert Holmes' best. The Gunfighters, which is unfairly maligned. Time Monster, which is fairly maligned. Twin Dilemma, which is very fairly maligned. Galaxy 4, which I think has a lot going for it, but that is mostly on the director rather than the writer. Time Lash, which Simon Gurrier did a great job defending, but again, there's a Venn diagram, and Simon is in the middle of a very narrow intersection. Then we had the book Turlough and the Earthling Dilemma, which is on nobody's list of the greatest literature of all time. Mm-hmm. And we're starting to come out of that now, because I see Fury from the Deep coming up in my schedule. I see Black Orchid. I see The Mine Robber coming up in my schedule. I see Reign of Terror coming up. But, of course, we also have the novelization of Celestial Toymaker in a few weeks. So we are in the middle of a run of Doctor Who Lit, where the stories that are being adapted are not top 60s. But do you believe that of every Doctor Who story ever made, King's Demons, which has a good song, which is a pseudo-historical, which has Anthony Ainley, a very underrated performer in it, and a very good guest cast, including Isla Blair, Mrs. Julian Glover, does King's Demons belong on a list of Doctor Who's 60 best?
Yeah, hopefully you're going to follow it up with that difference between best and favorite as well. Objectively,
that is my second question.
Yeah. Objectively, no, it's not in the top 60.
But if you were to think about your favorites and you were to assemble your own top 60 list, as I did and read off on the show last year, would you have The King's Demons on it?
I don't. But again, I don't really. There's maybe four stories in total of the classic era where I would say, if you're pretending that you like this, you're deluded and you need help and we need to do a sort of intervention. Most stories have got something that you can like about it. And as you just mentioned, this has got a gorgeous cast. I mean, Christopher Villiers, he was the sort of person who, like Christopher Cazenove and Anthony Andrews had just been through and they'd played the sort of foppish male lead in a lot of things. And then Christopher Villiers is coming along and he's sort of taken that role just as it's gone a little bit out of fashion. But he's in a lot of those murder mysteries where he turns out to be the villain because he does that sort of snotty attitude really well. And then as he gets older, he's in things like Ultraviolet, and it's that's the British Ultraviolet about vampires, not the other one. And he's just a very solid actor. And you've got Frank Windsor, who this is the first of two appearances he makes, and he's following Stratford Johns as this year's big guest star who was made famous by Z Cars, and we're going to have a load of those coming up. I think it's a beautiful performance from him. A little bit of an oddity, Michael Jackson. Michael J. Jackson.
not the vocalist.
Not the singer, no. Sir Geoffrey. And he had a run in the Liverpool soap Brookside. And that was how I found out he is another one of the notable Scousers that we're going to be talking about during Terror of the Vervoids, which I'd forgotten about. But so and obviously Gerald Flood. It's a huge performance. He's eating the scenery, and he's dripping with whatever he's been eating. It's a very greasy performance, and it's brilliant. He's got such a beautiful voice, and it's a shame in a way that having been able to do the physical performance, that they couldn't have found a way to do his voice more often, and find a way of having him voice that puppet more often than just Planet of Fire. But I'm glad we've got Planet of Fire. But it is a very slight story after all that. So it's not the sort of thing you can go, oh, it on its own, it's a very sort of empty story. There's not really a lot to it. However, it connects back to Time Flight. It also connects forward to both the Five Doctors. Because the Master's TARDIS is fitted with the TCE, which presumably is going to have some sort of horrific effect. What if this is the point where he's taken out of time and dragged to Gallifrey to meet the Time Lords for the Five Doctors? And for a moment, they've kind of saved his life. And maybe if he'd been more successful. I mean, he's actually the victim of the Five Doctors, but maybe if he'd been more successful in convincing the Doctors that actually for once he was on their side, he would have had a better time, because he's sent back to his own TARDIS, immediately triggers the TCE, and then the next time we see him, he's shrunk down to doll size in Planet of Fire. So this story doesn't really have a lot for itself, but it does throw back and forward to a lot of other stories.
Peter Grimwade has a different explanation for the shrinking in the novelization of Planet of Fire, which works to the detriment of your theory, but I prefer your theory because you're right. It makes perfectly logical sense that the TCE is firing into the interior. Anybody who walks through that door is going to get zapped. And it makes sense that the Time Lords, without even thinking, would send the Master right back to that, triggering his being cut down to size, to coin a phrase.
I mean, it could also be he walks in, realizes the TCE is in an unfortunate position, and is doing experiments to try and fix it. And that still goes along with what Peter Grimwade says. But it's just the basic idea of the Five Doctors is a bit like they've all stepped out of time. It doesn't really count. You might as well just go, it was all a dream. It doesn't really count, except for the fact that it became such a monolith with the future of Doctor Who that so many references come from it. But it's quite significant, I think, that when Sarah Jane meets the 10th Doctor, she doesn't quite remember the Five Doctors the way we might expect her to. So maybe that was wiped from her memory as well, which is a shame because it's the best story ever.
One of the last times you were on this show, you exploded I'm not going to say fan myth, but you exploded the received fan wisdom that Jean Marsh was a companion of the Doctor. Is Chameleon a companion?
Chameleon gets to feature in the Caves of Androzani ghostly heads, so yes, but not on screen. So in the same way that Sarah Kingdom, thanks to fan writing and thanks to Big Finish, has become a companion. But she wasn't supposed to be on screen. Chameleon is supposed to be a companion, and it's just unfortunate that it didn't work out. He was written to be in other stories, even if he would have only been lurking in the TARDIS and not going around the sea base or not going around Frontios, because it might have, they're already a bit skittish in Frontios, and for him to be walking around might have frightened them. He's a companion, just not one that we actually see.
there's a theory, and I don't know if it tracks, but there's a theory that the malfunctioning or the suddenly electricity zapping hat stand in front of you is chameleon in disguise. I may have gotten that from the discontinuity guide. There are two.
I never thought of that, but that's hilarious.
I think it's in the discontinuity guide. I'll have to dig that one out. There are two novels that have chameleon. Craig Hinton wrote one, which has chameleon painted on the cover. That's the Crystal Bucephalus. And then there's a Chris Bullis novel later on, which I will not spoil which one, because chameleon is a surprise appearance. But chameleon does return in one of the Chris Bullis novels, and he's not revealed to be chameleon until the very end. But it's a way, it's Chris Bullis' way of giving chameleon a more satisfactory and heroic exit than he got in Planet of Fire, which is tragic and very well done. But he gets a better second death scene in this Chris Bullis novel, which I will not say which one it is, but I'm sure most listeners of the show already know.
And he's, of course, Big Finish will never leave a stone unturned, and they've done a marvelous job with Chameleon. John Culshaw is a, and it's another great performance from John Culshaw. And it's lovely that they recognise that Chameleon is a really tragic artificial character. It's not quite going to the depths of Measure of a Man with Data, but it's they at least give him a certain level of depth.
Coming to our third and final Darren Mooney question, I am going to slightly repurpose this question. If someone has not seen Doctor Who before, is the King's Demons a good jumping off point to get them into the show?
Oh, I thought you were going to do the question that I suggested the other week. I mean, your proof that you can watch an absolutely dreadful couple of episodes of Doctor Who and still become a fan. So, you know, your origin story with your radioactive time flight and Ark of Infinity, making you a literature superhero. So I suppose if you're interested in history and then you suddenly watch this and go, this is really weird, and it captures your imagination, then great. I think as fans, we worry about, oh, well, you can't have this as your first because you don't understand what the Master is and you don't understand what Tegan and Turlough are, and you don't. It doesn't matter. Whatever your first one's going to be, it's not a bad one to start with. And in some ways, it's probably a good one because the next one's going to be so much better. And the one after that's quite good. And then you're in season 21. And with one notable exception, I think every single one of the stories in season 21 is great. So why not?
This may be a question that is answered by the BD raw material on the season 20 Blu-ray box set, which I have not yet properly dug my way through. I just watched enough to be part of the Trap One panel. The best line in this episode is they say he's the finest swordsman in all of France. And Peter Davison, who is terrific at deadpan lines like this, goes, "Fortunately, we're in England." That line, and that drum roll, was brought to you by Zencaster. That line does not appear in the novelization, leading me to believe that it was not part of Terence Dudley's original script, which begs the question, who wrote that line? Was it Eric Sayward? And it seems a little too witty and subtle to be Eric Sayward, or was that a Peter Davison rehearsal ad-lib that became part of the text? I lean towards the latter theory, but somebody else, including you, may know better.
I don't know. But there's that eternal battle with John Nathan Turner not wanting it to be funny. It's strange. John had a very, what you might call, a dry sense of humour. He could be absolutely outrageously bitchy, but he didn't. There were certain jokes that just wouldn't work with him. Peter's got quite a silly sense of humour, and I don't think they're a particularly good fit when it comes to working together. But I think those little victories that Peter gets with, like, just let me sneak in this little line, they're always good decisions. They always make sense. It's the jokes from other people, like Terence Dudley, funnily enough, that fall flat.
the Lin Futu joke in For a Doomsday being a quality example.
Exactly what I was thinking about. Yeah, it's another ghastly thing that is just, it just makes the Doctor sound really crude, I think.
Well, we've talked about the song. We've talked about Tegan. We've talked about Chameleon. We've talked about Anthony Ainley. We've talked about the guest cast. We've talked about the Darren Mooney questions and about one of the best lines of dialogue in the story. Is there anything else about the King's Demons that is a burning topic for discussion?
So this is what I was alluding to at the beginning of the show. The Sajil is the King's champion. And he's established, especially in the book, where he's surrounded by other French knights or French soldiers. And you have to ask yourself, is Sajil, in the context of this universe, a real person? Is he at the side of the real king, hanging out in Runnymede? And actually, that's a few months later. But, you know, is he really there? Or is he entirely a creation of the Master? And if so, has he spent a year setting this up by going on duels and creating a reputation like he did with Emile Keller? And this is when I started thinking, this really is the stupidest plot that the Master has ever come up with. Because he's putting all this effort into damaging the reputation of the king house by house. He's going around all of the supporters of the king and making them hate the king. But this king is the least popular king in history. So what does he hope to achieve? Because the king is already, you know, if we look at the established history, he's already on very dodgy ground. He's got a lot of enemies. They're getting more and more. He caused a war when he married his last wife because of she was engaged to somebody else. And he's just a very unpopular monarch. In fiction, he's the villain. He's the big bad in Robin Hood. So what is the Master trying to achieve? So is it that he wants to, I mean, this is more like a meddling monk scheme. Does he want credit for Magna Carta? Is it that he, because it's not that he's going to disrupt Magna Carta. He's going to make Magna Carta more of a certainty. So I was mentioning this, and I said I would love to be able to claim this as another one of my overactive headcanon ideas, but I can't take credit for this. This comes from the mind of the magnificent Hugh Haggerty, who online people might know as Captain Nifty. And he was also name-checked in an episode of the Sarah Jane Adventures as a character in one of Clyde Langer's comic books. Anyway, Hugh Haggerty suggests, the Master makes all of his plans so unnecessarily multi-layered, so they become intricate time events that draw the TARDIS to them. He's basically creating a kind of a puzzle that becomes a beacon. Now, we know that the TARDIS told the Doctor, I didn't necessarily take you where you wanted to go, but I took you where you needed to go. And it's almost like the Master's creating sort of virtual lodestones to draw the TARDIS towards him, because this happens time and time again. And when we were talking about the Mind of Evil, we were saying his plot is so convoluted, but it's not as convoluted as the one he does running from Legopolis through to Time Flight, which is particularly insane. And certainly Legopolis to Castro Valva, where he sends them all to the Big Bang and creates a fictional town and all this in one day. If this is a way of thinking of the Master, and especially the modern Master, where he is totally crazy, or they are totally crazy, if the plan needs to be crazy to attract the TARDIS to it, then suddenly it actually makes a lot more sense. And I think that's brilliant.
I may be the only person to remember this, but Chevy Chase, the comedian slash actor, was in the movie Fletch in the mid-1980s, and then a few years later does a disastrously received sequel called Fletch Lives. But he was being interviewed as part of the press kit for this story, and there was a short-lived American cable network called Movie Time, which later became E!, which is still around, I believe. But they were interviewing Chevy Chase, and he goes, the thing about Fletch, intrinsic to the character, is that he uses disguises even when he doesn't need to. So that, I think, is part of the appeal of the Anthony Anley master. There's no reason for him to be the Portreeve. There's no reason for him to be Sir Gilles. There's no reason for him to be a scarecrow standing in the field in the middle of 19th century Industrial Revolution England getting pieces of coal chucked at him by Luddites. But he does it anyway because he's the Anthony Anley master and he just enjoys this. Your theory, however, that he needs to be as crazy, or your friend's theory that he needs to be as crazy as possible to attract the TARDIS, possibly makes more sense, character-wise.
Also, the master, I don't think he's necessarily dressed as a scarecrow. I think his TARDIS is disguised as a scarecrow. But as you often say, you know, if a TARDIS can disguise itself as anything, where's the door? So it's quite a difficult thing where he's literally climbing out of a scarecrow. I'd like to see him climb back in. Just saying.
And of course he doesn't, because he's last seen in that story being menaced by a poorly realized rubber dinosaur. But that is a story for another day when we get to the Master's return in, I believe, the ultimate faux novelization is one of two times that Pip and Jane Baker explain how the Master escaped that particular trap. And then it comes up again, I believe, in Time and the Ronnie.
It's such a shame. I've literally that this second realized I could have written a song for Mark of the Rani, but it would have just been a Bert and Ernie Sesame Street thing. Rubber dinosaur. Never mind.
Let's not spoil the sacred memory of Sesame Street by tying it into Mark of the Rani. I think Sesame Street is too good a plot reference for that show. All right, Jim, always a pleasure having you on. You're going to be back on the show very, very soon to discuss a Target book that is not a novelization, and I will not spoil which one, but most of my eagle-eared listeners probably know exactly which story you're coming back for. We will see you in a few weeks.
See you soon. Bye.
Doctor Who, The King's Demons, by Terence Dudley, televised as The King's Demons, teleplay by Terence Dudley, televised in March 1983, paperback release date July 10th, 1986, target book number 108, cover artist David McAllister. It is March 4th, 1215, and the TARDIS materializes in England during a jousting match held in the presence of King John. But it soon becomes apparent to the Doctor that something is very seriously wrong. Why does John express no fear or surprise at the time traveler's sudden appearances, and indeed welcome them as the King's Demons? And what is the true identity of Sir Gilles Zestram, the King's Champion? Very soon the Doctor finds himself involved in a fiendish plan to alter the course of world history by one of his oldest and deadliest enemies. Hello, my name is Jason. I'm not only your host on this journey, this very long journey, but I also love The King's Demons, unreservedly. So, why don't you? It's almost a checklist of what I want in Doctor Who. A medieval setting, the Master doing something different, and the catchy song. Perhaps people think this story is dull, frivolous, inconsequential. Of course, people also think that the rings of Akatan or Wild Blue Yonder are soaring triumphs of the human spirit. As Doctor Who fans, our mileages vary. But I'll say this. For all the complaints I hear about Pertwee six-parters being, quote, two episodes too long, my least favorite bit of Doctor Who fans' conventional wisdom, here in the Davison era, we finally get two-part stories as a way of killing off the six-parter for all time, and Doctor Who fan doesn't like them, each of the three ranking lower on the usual lists of Davison from best to worst. Terence Dudley's novelization of his second two-parter, as with his later adaptation of the first one, Black Orchid, which is months away on this show, mostly improves on the TV story, and also resolves some of the criticisms of King's Demons that I've seen mentioned over the years, although not necessarily the ones raised by Jim a few minutes ago. The discontinuity guide said Magna Carta wasn't a big deal in 1215, its importance having been, quote, fabricated in the 17th century. But because Dudley is working with 147 pages of text, a similar page count to what Target was giving for or even six-part stories here in 1986, he's able to augment literally every dialogue exchange and expand a character's internal thoughts and motivations. And so Dudley answers the charge, 9 years before Discontinuity Guide leveled it, that Magna Carta was the vital first step toward parliamentary democracy, and that if the Master kicks it away, hundreds of years of incremental liberalism will never take place. Now, this may be small-time villainy, as the Doctor says on TV, but it's still more logical than most of the nonsense that Anthony Ainley's Master got up to in the 1980s, criticizing his scheme in The King's Demons when there's so much low-hanging fruit in Time Flight, Mark of the Rani, Missy's Tortured, I still have no idea what she was doing in The Magician's Nephew, Sacha Dhawan's 19 concurrent plans in The Power of the Doctor, good luck explaining that scheme on the back of a postcard, and even Castrovalva, love the story, not quite sure what the Portreeve is for. It's pointless. If the worst thing you can say about King's Demons is that the Master's scheme is bad, well, go nitpick on someone else's show. King's Demons is hardly a unique offender in the annals of Doctor Who. The book also gives tons of added historical background about the Plantagenets and Angevins. Apologies on the pronunciation, but once you've watched Frontios, you can never go back to saying Plantagenet any other way. And also more details about the allegations of witchcraft in King John's family that it would have been possible to provide on TV. Oh, and the reference to Lord Dudley of Grimswade is the rare pun that manages to name-check two Season 20 scriptwriters in the same breath. Dudley's prose at its best can be rich and satisfying. The book's first sentence is, "The king tore the meat from the bone with his teeth and grunted his way through the mouthful of food with satisfaction." That's a pretty solid opening, as Target books go. Clever hints are dropped early on that King John is not who he claims to be, as he muses over a famous lost battle that was, quote, not his fault, or looks out from, quote, metallic eyes. Dudley uses a lot of archaic words like caitiff, a sadly forgotten insult, to bolster that period feel. The Master, when disguised as Sir Giles, is described as a flagitious Frenchman. Lord Fitzwilliam's castle is given an improved layout. We spend more time in the dungeons, stables, secret corridors, and get a better look at the Baron's cloak collection. Of course, there are times when Dudley could have benefited from more strict copy editing. If you're wondering why the novelization was fairly late in receiving an audiobook adaptation, it's almost certainly because of sentences like these. Quote, "The Doctor turned towards the still cringing, croaking Master, marveling that this always arrogant and contumelious enemy should be reduced so despicably to this display of utterly contemptible cowardice." As Jim mentioned earlier, Dudley tells the book from a dizzying array of POVs. We learn how the Master manipulates the medieval barons by pretending to be their, quote, guide, philosopher, and above all, friend. There are some interesting snippets of the Doctor's personal philosophy. He decides to help Lord Fitzwilliam because, quote, he liked the man and was going to stay just as long as it took to give it to him. The Doctor, who is often played by Peter Davison as an old man in a young man's body, remarks on the loss of manners in Tegan's time and, quote, tried to think of the last time he'd seen anyone in the 20th century raise his hat. We're told the Doctor was, quote, never more active than when seeming to be relaxed and carefree, which is a wonderful description of the character. The only thing lost, sadly, is the Doctor's comment when fencing with Sir Giles, the best swordsman in France, that, quote, fortunately we're in England. It's odd to lose one of the script's wittier lines in a book that otherwise greatly enriches the TV dialogue. I'm guessing that line, like I said earlier, must have been a Sayward addition, or more likely a Davison ad-lib that didn't appear in the draft script that Dudley was working from. Jim Sangster also told me a theory, offline, that Cedric the Jailer must be a reference to the Scottish play. Cedric the Jailer being a comedy character in a scene that allows Macbeth and Lady Macbeth to get off stage and wash their hands before the next big bit of Shakespearean business. Not a theory that I would have come up with myself, and that's why I have guests on this show, especially Jim. One failure of the book, though, and this is a big failure, is its portrayal of Tegan. I've always been a fan of Janet Fielding's work on TV, and so have you. Dudley, however, is that same author who gave us Four to Doomsday, in which Tegan also comes across very badly. While it's dangerous to generalize about age, I'll point out that Dudley was 62 when he started writing for Doctor Who, and even older than that when he wrote his two novelizations, making him perhaps the oldest author to write a novelization. Dudley's age is perhaps shown by his including a direct reference to the Crusade, or naming the final chapter A Battle of Wits, which is the same as the last episode of The Time Meddler. Please prove me wrong, but perhaps Dudley was simply of the wrong generation to understand Tegan's potential. How else to explain the innumerable references, mostly from the Doctor's POV, oddly, to Tegan being annoying? Quote, Tegan's feminine superficiality irritated him. Quote, it was only natural that the practical feminine mind would demand of the proverbial Englishman's home that it have a backyard. Quote, he wasn't used to being spoken to in such a fashion, being on the receiving end of peremptory orders from a maroon stewardess from an Antipodean airline. And who could forget, quote, she resorted to the irresistible violence of feminine wiles. The master gets in on it too, saying, the female mind is cunning, but undisciplined.
You would do well, my dear doctor, to ponder that you played directly into my hand.
And into ours.
He has a mind of his own,
indeed,
but highly susceptible.
Dominated by our demons.
You will know that the king and his dead brothers are believed to be the devil's work. Your interference here with your dreary TARDIS has only confirmed this. You are, dare I say so, discredited demons, and as such you make a unique contribution to altering the course of history. Hoist on your own petard.
And where will you take your toy next?
Does it matter? You'll not be there to greet me.
I may not need to, you forget. Chameleon does have a mind of his own.
He obeys only my will.
Yes, but for how much longer?
For as long as I command it. Chameleon will not turn on me.
No.
You're getting old, Doctor. Your will is weak. It's time you regenerated.
You won't win, not ultimately.
You're mistaken! With Chameleon's unique ability at my command, it's only a matter of time before I undermine the key civilizations of the universe. Chaos will reign, and I shall be its emperor.
Earth is a primitive planet. You won't succeed so easily elsewhere.
Where I cannot win by stealth, I shall destroy. That way I cannot fail to win.
You'll never succeed.
Unfortunately, you will not be alive to find out.
Two fairly radical alterations to the TV plot makes the novelization quite different from what we saw on TV. These alterations also answer common criticisms of the TV. It is said that TARDIS's arrival in 1215 was due to the intervention of the Time Lords. Now, that may not add very much to the story. In the TV canon, King's Demons is one of the last times the Doctor lands somewhere without having been deliberately piloted or steered. I think only Caves of Androzani does this afterwards. Second is the new ending. On TV, the Doctor loses Lord Fitzwilliam as an ally halfway through, and never regains his trust. He leaves without ever reconciling with the Baron, or proving convincingly that the Chameleon was not, in fact, the real King John. That's an irritating loose end. Dudley remedies that in the novel, first by having Ranulph look inside the TARDIS, and thus pushing him close to madness, but then by having the Doctor save the life of Geoffrey de Lacy, who perished on TV, and having a sentimental farewell chat with Fitzwilliam and his wife. I'm not sure if Dudley intended for this to happen in the original script, or because he recognized the shortcoming and added the material to the book to improve the story. Either way, I prefer this new ending, which makes the story more well-rounded and complete. One final note about Tegan. On TV, the story ends with Tegan threatening to leave the TARDIS and the Doctor charming her back with the idea of a trip to the Eye of Orion. Here, the book ends abruptly, with Tegan demanding to go back to London Airport, and that's that. No trip to the Eye of Orion, no lead-in to the Five Doctors, no suggestion that Tegan has five more TV stories to go, and quite a different abrupt departure in mind. It is the mishandling of Tegan
That spoils what, for me, is otherwise a pretty terrific novelization. Next time, on Doctor Who Literature, we go back again to the William Hartnell era, where I am so much at home. It is the belated novelization of a particular television writer's debut Doctor Who story. It is also the first Target novelization for one Ian Stewart Black, with two more to follow after this one, as he novelizes his three TV scripts out of order. We are also getting the novelization of the final story, the one of my favorite TV companions, Mr. Stephen Taylor, as played so winningly by Peter Purvis. It is the novelization of Doctor Who, The Savages. Join me and a first-time guest who will have unique stories to tell about working with the Doctor Who canon. Thank you for joining me on another episode of Doctor Who Literature. This podcast is executive produced by David Barsky and is produced by Jim Sangster and yours truly. This week's episode was written and edited by me. Our logo was designed by Jim Sangster. Special thanks to my special guest, Jim Sangster. This podcast can be found on most of your podcast apps of choice. You can find all past episodes at podcasters.spotify.com/pod/show/Doctor Who Lit. It really helps if you rate 5 stars and subscribe. You can find me on Blue Sky and YouTube at Doctor Who Novels. That's Dr. Who Novels. And on email at Doctor Who Literature. That's Dr. Who Literature at gmail.com. Please drop me a line with your comments, questions, and suggestions. Thank you for listening, and whatever you do, keep turning the pages.
Doctor Who Podcast Network.